Okay, good evening, everybody. We'll go ahead and get started since it's already 7 o'clock. Welcome to the first meeting of 2022. Our guest speaker this evening is Juan Hernandez. He's one of the forecasters at the local National Weather Service office here in Fort Worth, Texas. It's been, 6 years now, Juan, since you joined officially full-time with us? At the WFO. He's got a bachelor's and master's degree, Texas A&M grad, military university as well, man of many talents, and is going to give us a presentation, some research that he and Jennifer Dunn, the WCM at the local forecast office, worked on regarding last year's historic February event. So with that, I will go ahead and pass it off to you.
Awesome. Thank you, Amanda. For everyone that doesn't know me, and I know some of you have come over to the office whenever, you know, before COVID, you might have seen me there in the forecast desk. But whoever doesn't know me, my name is Juan Hernandez. I am a forecaster here at the Fort Worth office. I've been there since, 2016. I did do my bachelor's at Texas A&M University. Then I went over to Pennsylvania to Millersville University to finish my master's there. I know a lot of you are familiar with the February winter storm that we had here in Texas, actually across much of the country. But something that was interesting was the response that we had in social media across the entirety of the event. For this specific case, we decided to look only at Twitter, since the analytics in Twitter were a little easier to analyze. And we've recently found out that it's actually very difficult to do analytics in Facebook now, since June of this past year. Let's see here. All right, there we go. So in case you've all forgotten, we had a significant winter storm that basically affected much of the country, but specifically we're going to look at the effects here across the region, north and central Texas. These are a couple of pictures that were taken during the event. The one on the left was from Grand Prairie, and then the one on the right was taken here in the office sometime during the event. I'm not exactly sure. Since it's all kind of blurring together. So we're going to talk about the beginning. We're going to talk about the event first, and then we're going to dive into the analytics. And I apologize if you hear children screaming. It is currently bedtime, and they don't want to go to bed, so I apologize for that. So taking it back to before it all started. So we began to see the beginning stages of what looked like a possible winter event. We could see some cold weather. We weren't sure how cold. We weren't sure if we were going to get precipitation. But the tweet on the left was actually issued, or was tweeted on January 28th. So that's about 2 weeks prior to the bulk of the wintry precipitation we received. So those were the first indications that we had. And of course, we were getting tweets, or we were getting replies like the bottom one here, where it says, OMG, the polar vortex, or might it just get cold like it's supposed to in winter, LOL. So little did people know that it was actually going to get significantly colder than what we're supposed to. So the model started hinting at the possibility of the cold air arriving sometime, probably the first week, the latter half of the first week of February. Then CPC began to highlight that area by the first couple of days in February. They were highlighting the area basically with a slight chance of hazardous temperatures throughout much of Texas, with a moderate area across basically northeastern portions of Texas. The image you have on the right I mean, on the left, that has the mid-level pattern that we saw across the country. And in to summarize how that cold air got here, I'm going to use that term that was used in that previous tweet, the polar vortex. So the polar vortex meandered across Canada and eventually just kind of sat there. And it didn't move anywhere for about a week or so. And because it was stagnant across basically eastern and central portions of Canada, that allowed for continuous cold air to make its way southward. One cold front at a time, it would make its way down south, deepening that cold air across our area. Now, to summarize kind of what happened over the course of about a week and a half or so, we're going to start with February 6th for this in this case. So that's when the cold air arrived. February 6th, there wasn't really much happening. It was getting cooler. We started to see the temperatures drop below freezing. At the same time, we started seeing continuous nights, about two or three nights of freezing drizzle across areas west and north of the Dallas-Fort Worth area. We all are familiar with the Fort Worth pileup that occurred on the 11th. But there was also quite a bit of ice that occurred across central Texas that day and continued through the entirety of the storm across central Texas, the Hill Country. We're going to take a look at those pictures. Then the last kind of couple of days there with the heavy snow, the significant cold air, the power outages that affected the entire state. So taking a look back at the kind of the initial stages of what was going to be the beginnings of a major winter storm that would last for a couple of days. Here's a look at the sounding on February 11th. So as I mentioned earlier, February 11th was the day that I-35 pileup occurred in Fort Worth. You see the radar screen there wasn't much precipitation going on that day. It was just a couple of showers that had developed. But the sounding on the left, you see that it was actually below freezing, but it was only below freezing for the lowest 2,000 feet or so. Above 2,000 feet, we had a layer of above freezing temperatures, which is never a good sign when it comes to freezing rain. In this case, it was freezing rain, but it can also occur during freezing drizzle. The lower levels are cold, you get those super cooled water droplets freeze on contact. Same thing happened here with those showers freezing on the roadways. Although, we had a trace of freezing rain up here in the Metroplex, there was significantly more ice across central Texas, where Temple started to pick up a little bit more ice. And we're gonna look at some pictures here, but on the bottom right, you see that picture from about 30 miles southwest of land passes where there was quite a bit of ice accumulation. And that picture that just appeared is actually from Bell County, where there was a lot of tree damage that occurred because of this first round of ice. Now, as we continue to the next couple of days, Texas just really wanted to celebrate Valentine's Day. So this is Valentine's Day here, where the entire state is pink, which means the entire state is under a winter storm warning. Actually, if I were to zoom out and look at the entire nation, it would actually be from Texas over to about Maine. There was a continuous line of warnings and advisories, blizzard warnings as well. But here we have the entire state under a winter storm warning for Valentine's Day. Now that winter storm warning was issued because of, we were expecting a couple of rounds of snow to occur. So here's the first round that occurred Valentine's Day into the next day. Basically, we already had the cold air. We had continuous bursts of snow that developed across the entire region. And this was just a couple of disturbances that would move across the state. So this is over a two-day period. You see there that Sunday afternoon, we began to see quite a bit of snow. Then we see another round of snow develop by Monday morning. And throughout those 2 days, here's a amount of storm total snowfall. With that first round of snow, where, you know, Dallas-Fort Worth actually, you know, they were in this wedge of lower amounts with higher amounts to the west and even higher amounts to the southeast, where about 6 to 8 inches of snow fell. Now we go on to the second round here on February 16th and 17th, where you know, that round of snow was a little bit lighter this time. It was another disturbance that was moving across. You see that first round kind of develop off to the northwest, and again, there was another round that developed off to the southeast. And here are these storm totals for that second round, where about 3 to 4 inches of snow fell up in just north of Bowie, with another band of snow, 3 to 4 inches, just along I-30. Now, this is a satellite view of February 15th, the day after Valentine's Day, where basically the entire state of Texas was covered in snow. The exception was down in the valley, down closer to Brownsville, where they did not receive quite as much precipitation as we did up here. So over the course of about 5 days or so, you can see the storm total snowfall on the left, and then the ice accumulation map with that second round that occurred between February 14th and 17th, where the highest ice totals were concentrated off to the southeast. So the significant cold, you know, also broke records. So here are a couple of broken records from DFW. So over the course of 4 days, you know, we had record low temperatures each day, with a record low temperature of -2 on the 16th, with a previous record of 12 from 1903. The records also were broken everywhere across you know, the region. I don't have the records specifically for Waco here, but you can follow the trend with DFW and assume that those records were also broken down there. So given that we had, you know, those multiple rounds of snow and freezing rain, we already had a plan in place for communicating how we were going to how we were going to outlook and or how we were going to pass along that information over to the public. So before we even started this event, we actually had what you see on the right, a winter weather communications guide. So this was put together by one of our forecasters. And when we look at this, it's important to realize that, you know, risk communication is not a single product. You can't communicate the risk in one product, but rather it's a process that takes multiple days. It actually begins before there is even an event in sight. So it starts with preparation for something like this. So in this case, you know, we had our communications guide ready. We pulled it out when we saw that something like this was coming. So we were in the initial outlook stage. We started talking about the potential for a significant cool down as early as late January. And then as we continued to get closer, those outlooks started to get a little more concise as we began to see that it was really going to get into the record territory. Now, as we move into the actual analytics, so this was here's a timeline of the tweets that were issued from February 6th through the 19th, and a general categorization of those tweets. So you'll see that those tweets were broken down into five different categories: the outlook, the short-term forecasts, the current obs and radar. So that's tweeting a loop of the current radar, temperatures, maybe some screen grabs of what's going on the TechSoc cameras. Then we also have the educational or informative tweets. This is more for letting people know what's going on. So how do you, why do we have snow as opposed to freezing rain? Also informative, like where to get information, where to get the road closures, how to get road conditions. And then preparedness. Preparedness is more for how to, you know, go about in the middle of a winter storm, what do you need if you're traveling outside? You know, don't put any kind of generator inside your house. You know, stuff like that. That's what is considered preparedness. So you can see that there was a general uptick in tweets as we got closer to February 14th, which was, you know, the bulk of the storm. And you see it all started with outlooks. So, you know, it begins February 6th here, but those outlooks were actually as early as January 28th. I was taking a look back and we had additional outlooks that were in February 2nd, I believe. We also issued another one saying it was going to get significantly colder with a couple of other information from the other centers across the National Weather Service. So as I mentioned earlier, the tweets were broken down into five categories where, you know, the outlook, the short-term forecast, the education, informative, current weather, and preparedness. Now, it was very interesting to look at how these different categories stacked up with regards to tweets, retweets, and likes. It was actually something I did not expect. I was expecting it to be a little more heavy on, you know, people really like to know, you know, maybe the current obs or the educational or informative or even the short-term forecast. Like, I'm planning on going to the grocery store. What do I need to know? But actually, the preparedness tweets got the most likes and the most retweets when it comes to Twitter. Now, we'll talk about why that potentially is the case. But people really did not react to these kinds of tweets. They did react to preparedness. They did not react as well to let's say, the outlook, which was in the long term. So overall performance, here we have a timeline of the tweets, the retweets, and the likes throughout the entire event. So this is looking at the timeline of and maybe, you know, what could have contributed to people beginning to pay attention to the weather. So it was pretty quiet as we started out, you know, that first week of February. You see that it was fairly low retweets, fairly low likes. Then we started getting a little bit more attention as we got closer to the 10th. Then we had that Fort Worth pileup. And you see that pick up there with retweets and likes. Now that continued to pick up through the 15th. But it's important to realize here why there's a spike on the 15th. So on the 15th, we retweeted the picture you have on the right. So it's a tweet that was done by Camille down in central in Central Texas. And she was comparing the temperature in Alaska with Texas. Now, looks like people really liked it because that actually became the most popular tweet of the entire event. It was not our tweet. We just simply retweeted it. So it's possible that it's likely that those numbers are skewed toward that one graphic on the 15th. So if we were to take that that graphic on the 15th and omit it from the calculations, our climax would have actually occurred on the 14th, which is important as we continue to look at the data. So the precipitation then continued through the 17th, at which case the retweets and the likes dropped back to, I wouldn't say back to normal, because there was quite a bit of talk and chatter in social media, even after the event. But we do see our lowest retweets and likes of once the event started. Now here is where the data starts to get a little interesting. So I'm gonna focus on the graph. So the graph itself has, it is comparing the views of our Twitter content, and it's also comparing the engagement. So the dark blue line is the engagement rate. Now it does vary from day to day, but you do see that there's a general increase increase in the engagement rate as we continue through the event. The views also significantly increase as we continue through the event. So this is the views, total views per day of our content. So, you know, February 6th, we're getting about 70,000, 71,000 views. We continue that increase. We hit about 1 million views by February 11th. And that spikes up to almost 3 million by the 15th. Now, that rapid increase is significant because, so engagement rate, which is plotted in the dark blue, that's calculated by taking a look at the number of engagements divided by the total number of views. So an engagement means that we are clicks, retweets, replies, follows, and likes. So basically anybody that clicks on that tweet or retweets or does anything with it, that's considered an engagement. So you would think that with the increased number of views, you would have an increasing number of engagement. But actually we did not see that after February 13th. So February 13th was our peak engagement rate. You know, I would have thought that as we continue through the event, people would start or would continue to share that information. They would click on it, they would retweet, but that was just not the case. Or it continued, but it did not continue at the same pace that the views increased. So you see that the views jumped, you know, from 1 million to almost 3 million within a matter of 3 days, and the engagement did not catch up to that. Now, then the question is why? So it's possible that the drop off that occurred on the 13th began because people were starting to get more concerned about what was going on outside of you know getting weather knowledge. So maybe they started to lose power. Maybe they started to have water issues. I know a lot of people here in Fort Worth and across the state had water boil notices, natural gas. So maybe those issues contributed to decreasing the amount of engagement. But also maybe that means that we need more call to actions in our tweets. For example, stating please share or breaking whenever we do have new information, something like that to catch people's attention and allow them to quickly do a retweet or a like or something. And this is interesting when it comes to social science. So it's come to be known that when it comes to hazard or expectations of hazards and how people prepare for those, people will get most of their information the day before the main event happens. So let's think about it in severe weather terms or the SPC products. It's the day two. You look at the day two forecast to make your decision rather than the day one. That's because you still have the perception of time that you have time to prepare for something. Once you're in day one, you're in this state of, well, it's happening today and I did what I could have done yesterday. Now we see what we can do. So in this case, it's possible that this also applied to the winter weather that we saw last year, that people had the perception that they were prepared for it because of what they did yesterday, as opposed to what they can do now when it's already going or ongoing. So as I was mentioning earlier, the main takeaway here or the what we were able to gather which was something that I was actually not very familiar with, was that, you know, when it comes to communicating risk to the public, that the day two period is very important. it's important for preparation purposes. And this is backed up by social science in both, you know, when it comes to hazard mitigation in the weather community, but it's also true in, you know, in other fields out there, like medicine as well. So the preparedness messaging got the most attention. I'm sorry, I need a sip here. preparedness messaging got the most attention. As I mentioned earlier, that was also something I did not expect. I would have thought that, you know, people wanted to look at those pictures of the radar, or people wanted to see pictures of what was going on out there. But in reality, people really wanted to know, what do I need to do to be able to get through this event? Now, it was a very intense event for a lot of people that lost, you know, the basic necessities. So for those people specifically, they wanted to know, where do I need to go, you know, for a shelter? How can I find some place to be warm? And it's important to avoid confusing an impact statement with a preparedness statement. So impact statements are, you know, telling you what is probably, or what could potentially happen to you, as opposed to a preparedness statement. It's telling you how to prepare for what could potentially happen to you. So the preparedness statement, again, it's taking it back to before it even happens, to prepare for anything like we experienced in February of last year. And again, we also you know, learned that preparedness messaging a few days in advance actually was more significantly received by those across North and Central Texas. And that was backed up by an analysis of the engagements across all of our tweets. Now, I didn't talk about Facebook much in this presentation, but I was also taking a look at the data there. And it's also very, very similar to what we saw here. Now, Facebook does give you a analysis of the people, of the demographics of who are taking a look at the data. So it was very interesting to see that that females between 30 and 35 were the ones that were interacting with our content on Facebook platform, as opposed to, you know, the older folks and then the younger folks. We did see this drop off, but it seemed like the females between 30 and about 35, those are the ones that that engaged with our content the most. Now, you know, although the preparedness graphics were the most interactive or interacted with on Twitter, it's important to realize that even forecast graphics are also looked at. They're just not as interacted with as opposed to preparedness. It might be just a factor of how you perceive that specific information. You know, it's a forecast. It's a forecast for me. It's more for prepare for myself, as opposed to once we begin to get into the event, once we know what's actually going to happen. You know, that's when the preparedness becomes probably more interacted with. So, as I mentioned earlier, it's possible that the results were impacted by the disruption to the basic needs, with so many people having lost electricity, you know, natural gas, water. I know that a lot of people actually, once the event started, you know, were trying to help their neighbors. You know, once you're in it, you know, a lot of things change in the human perspective and how you perceive all that information. So it's possible that there was also some of that going on here, since it was such a long event. We had multiple events that all impacted different people at different times. And everybody had a different perspective of what was going on. And I mentioned this earlier, but there are some differences, although there are some differences between the winter and the severe weather messaging. The research is very consistent across both types. So they both, taking a look at the severe weather research and messaging there, they show that the day two period is the optimal time to try to get your message across. It's when you want to get people's attention. It's when you want to get people to do something proactive before the actual day occurs. If you think about it, let's say it's day one and you're expecting storms at 2 or 3 p.m., it's possible you're at work, can't really do much. So it's the day two period, it's the day before, where you might say, all right, well, I might want to put my car in the garage or something like that to be proactive. Same concept is true here with winter weather. Now, that's about all I have here for you guys. You know, it was very interesting to see all this data. Going into the data blindly, I wasn't very familiar with this data. I just took a look at it and realized that there was definitely peaks in when people were interactive with the data, and there was a sharp drop off once the event started. So I think that's something to say about how we as people that were impacted by that storm went through the event. And it's very, it would be interesting to take a look at additional data. We don't have as much access to the Facebook analytics now. But as we continue to go through events, I think we might continue to see this trend as well. So, that's about all I have for you guys. If anybody has any questions, feel free to let me know.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Feel free to chime in if anybody's got any questions.
And do you think the loss of power in a lot of places may have contributed to the drop-off in interaction online?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. So I do think that the loss of power potentially led to that. So, once you lose power, you're not thinking about what could happen tonight. You're more concerned, if you have a family, if you've got someone to take care of, you're more concerned about finding shelter, finding a warm place for your family. And that was certainly the case for me. I didn't lose power here, but my friends did, and they had little kids. So, we had to bring them in. And I think that's the case across a lot of people. And that might've contributed to that drop off in engagement across Twitter.
Good evening, Juan. Thank you for your, and Jennifer, putting this together, how do you think you might use this data for future events?
That's a good question. So we actually started already using it. So I showed that social media guide about midway through the presentation. We've actually revamped that because of this data. So we've already made some changes to that, readjusted what our plan was depending on how many days away we are from such an event. And then we can take this same concept, the same data, and apply it to severe weather as we get into the severe weather season, or significant warmth, the day before a significantly hot day. So this same analysis, I think, can be used for preparedness in all hazardous weather.
Hey, Juan, this is Jennifer. Just to kind of add on to that, we've taken this step to start talking to some social scientists, especially the ones that were involved in the research that you mentioned in the presentation. And while they focused on severe weather, we talked to them about winter weather and started to draw some commonalities. So I think with a little bit more work with them, we'll continue to refine some more of that plan and maybe make changes. And we need to go back and look at the notes from the conversation with her to see what we still need to do there. But using this and that, it may shift our messaging plan some more as to when we start talking about certain things and in anticipation better of how the public will respond to that or how they will grasp that. Juan, there's one question too in the chat. I don't know if you saw it.
Let me take a look at it here. Yeah, so the question is, once we get to day one, might people be looking more at TV? So it's very possible. So once you get into day one, all the attention turns into this afternoon. And a lot of people, they have a TV around them. So it's quite possible that you're looking for information during the day one period. It's also a case where it might be, a little too late to do something about it. If we have storms that are coming up and you're not home to prepare for that. Same thing for winter weather. Since this was such a long event where we had quite a bit of disruptions in the infrastructure over multiple days, people were probably, people had more attention at the beginning of the event. They were engaging more at the event, beginning of the event where, we had the freezing drizzle, we had that I-35 pile up. Then they were more interactive with our tweets there. As we got into the event, they did slow down the day before the more significant weather happened. So it's possible, like you said, they might've been looking at TV or they were just trying to figure out what their next move was, depending on their situation.
I think it would be really interesting to compare an analysis when you're looking at a severe weather event or a heat event or something along those lines. And that might also give some kind of, I guess, a better idea of whether or not the power outages played a significant role and whether the drop-off is associated with that or other factors. So, but it's really, really interesting.
Yeah, so I was actually thinking about doing this for the heat, but we had a pretty mild summer here this past year. So I didn't think we had a big event to actually take a look at and analyze on Twitter Analytics.
It will be interesting to compare this with other winter events too, ones where we don't lose power. And I think that's something we're looking forward to taking a closer look at 10 years down the road when we get our next winter weather event, right, Juan?
Definitely.
Nothing until then.
Knock on wood.
Any other questions or comments? Well, thanks again for taking the time out of your evening to share all the information with us. Really appreciate it. And I will touch base with you. We've got a gift to send your way as our appreciation for talking with us this evening. I will tell you too, and you're more than welcome to join in on this meeting next month as well, but we're going to have one of the local emergency managers actually talk about operations from their perspective on this event for the next meeting in February on the 8th, I think it is, something like that. So the second Tuesday. So continuation of this event for next month. I don't have any specific chapter business other than if you haven't sent your dues in, feel free to send those in at your convenience. And I hope everybody has a happy and healthy start to the year, and we'll talk to everybody next month. Thanks again, Juan. Appreciate it.
It was my pleasure. Thank you.